Hello, everybody. My name is Jörg Fuhrmann, and I want to have a short presentation and impulse about the topic of money and what money, what role plays money in our lives and also in our transpersonal dimension. I want to give one question as an impulse, maybe for the after talk. What do you think does ayahuasca has to do with money? Could be many different things, and maybe you have an idea about it for yourself. We can maybe discuss it later. I had the feeling that money and ayahuasca, for example, or especially ayahuasca, have in common that they are catalysts and that they bring up shadows, that they make something clearer what is already there. And when we look at the topic of money, we have a big, big problem in our culture and in our world. And it's called the Midas complex. You know maybe the story. This king was quite addicted to gather more and more. And at first he wanted to gather the wisdom of the teacher of the god of the Greek god of ecstasy, Dionysus, and he called up his Dionysus teacher by giving him wine secretly, and he kept him. And then he said to Dionysus, "You have to fulfill me a wish, then I set him free again." And Dionysus said, "Okay, what do you need? What do you want?" And he said, "Okay, Silenus will be free when you make, you will give me the gift that everything I touch turns into gold." And so he did. But the King Midas realized very soon that this was not only a gift, but also a curse. Because everything he wanted to eat, he touched, turned into gold. And he nearly starved. And then even, you see it on the picture there down on the left, he turned his own daughter into gold. And so he fled and prayed to Dionysus, "Please, please make that this thing goes away again." So Bornemann called it the Midas complex, as a pathological greed for money, or you can say for gold. In the Aramaic tradition, we have the word mammon for it. There are also studies about what makes us happy or lucky. And there were, for example, studies at University of Pennsylvania by Stevenson and Wolfus. And they said that luck does not increase at a level of 9,000 euros per month. So if you have more than 9,000 euros per month, you are not more lucky than you are with 9,000 euros. So money has an influence on luck, but it's not exponential. So if you have 100,000, it doesn't make any difference to 9,000. So the conclusion is that, the key sentence is that more money doesn't make you happier. Problematic is that in the studies the term luck is not clearly defined. So, in spirituality and also in transpersonal psychology, we can say that money has has an existence to live that is quite under the curtain, not even under the table. It's even lower. It's like a taboo. It seems like that it's not existing even, or it's demonized, so it's evil. And me personally, I'm quite interested in things when they get, when things get hidden or pushed away. For me, this then I start to search. Interesting is in Buddhist economics, that is quite different. There are you can say actions you can do or should do. There's also a big part of self-responsibility, so that you are not that a broad mass is not I'm missing the word, responsible for your life and for your food and everything, so that you take care of yourself. And there are also clear rules, for example, don't deal with flesh, living animals or weapons to make a living. We have Maslow. Of course, it was not a pyramid, but it's known as a pyramid. And there are also money plays a big role, from my understanding. You need money to, for example, that you can pay for good food and can live in a country which is safe, or maybe leave a country which is not safe anymore. So just maybe also as an impulse for you, for those maybe who have a feeling of that money is something bad or not good, or that they don't deserve money. You need money for different things. Also, you need money to be here. And many couldn't be here because it was too expensive. And it was even said, this isn't transpersonal because the price is too high. Interesting. So, maybe also as a question, is it true that if something which has a high quality has a price, is it not transpersonal because of the price anymore? Important question. And yeah, we need it for good education, for also for spiritual training, or maybe even like Maslow said, the basic needs like healthy food and water. If you want to eat organic, Demeter standard, you have to pay a lot of money per month. If you want to drink water which is filtered, for example, or which has a six-star structure, which is healthy and living, you have to pay a lot of money for that water. If you do it consequently, it's expensive. Holistic healthcare, mostly not covered by insurances. Or if you want to have a house, maybe which is built in organic structure, and which you want to own and not have it in debt, you need a lot of money. And also, if you want to help others, what is quite an important aspect of transpersonal psychology, if you want to help others, you need money. If you have no money, you cannot help anybody. Ever try to grab a naked man in the pocket? My grandfather often said, who also has to flee from Eastern Europe after the war. Money. Yeah. So money is our old companion, but it has not, it had never had the role before like it had today. It started in the 14th century. Before, it was more in the cultic and in the legal spheres. And of course it was gold, but it also grains and foods or weapons and pearls and different other things were used as money. Yeah, I will talk tomorrow about another aspect of important aspect of this, but I don't want to say too much. What is important, it was something which one can repay or pay penance. It's really important. And then, when we came to the time when the temples were built, I mean, the most sacred places that a society found for itself, there money was brought or even created. It means these are the places where the gods lived in Greek mythology. And the humans brought the money there as a form of sacrifice because they were feeling in guilt or, yeah, they wanted to give an offer to the gods. But the topic of guilt is already there. So, and the money was collected more and more, and the priests were watching over it. So you can say, at a certain point, it switched and the temples were the first banks. Interesting is also that there's a Roman goddess called Moneta. 289 BC. And the interesting thing is that her temple was in the Roman capital and it was a mint place where the mints were printed by state, by government in that time. And she also symbolizes how's it called? The scale. Yeah, thank you. The scale. There's also a parallel to Justitia, I think, maybe. Yeah, she's holding it on there. So she's a personification of a coin minting machine, you can say. The goddess, quite interesting. And out of Moneta came the term money and the German word Münze. And later, we got it in the Middle Ages, especially in German-speaking European countries, but also in Italy, that Johann Tetzel, he was the son of a goldsmith, also an interesting fact, was traveling around the whole area and countries and was selling these gilt enactment letters to the public, and he was doing theatralic insinuations, like theater drama play, to the masses, so that they really felt in guilt, and that they really were afraid of what could come in the future. And there's a German saying, wenn die Münze im Kasten klingelt, deine Seele aus dem Fegefeuer springet, heißt es in Deutsch. If the money sounds in the box, the soul jumps out of the fire. And the extended version to this is, if you give me your money, then your dead relatives will no longer burn in hell, but will come to heaven. So you can repay the guilt, not only for yourself, but also for your dead relatives. It's quite shamanistic. Huh? So you can say, at that point, the church went back in their own belief to shamanism. And they built St. Peter's with it. It was the first, you can say, broad-scale advertisement thing which was really successful on a broad scale. Yeah, and the switch is from, we switched from sinners to debtors. Maybe we are still sinners, but we don't often realize it, because it's gone unconscious, because many people don't believe in churches and so on anymore. But most people are in debt. And this is, when you go back to this thing here, it's the same. And then when you take a look at this, 1% of the population has as much as the rest. So, and when you look at the situation today, now in Europe, it is like in a labyrinth. We put in so many, so much money, we have to feed a monster. And we put in the money as in these packages of the national banks and to save other banks. There's so much behind it because the people are in a sort of trance. They want to buy everything now. They want to. They want just the kick. They want to solve their dreams, and they want to. They postpone the pain because they don't change real money anymore. They just use a credit card, and so they get more and more into debt. And we have an obligation for consuming, and a compulsion for infinite growth. And the really important point is that most people think that banks use the money which they own, which they have deposits, and that they give it out again to the people. But this is not true. The bank gives the money, there's magic involved, 85% in EU and 91% in UK is not created by central banks, it is created by private banks. So they only have 1% of the money in their accounts, and they give away, if you put 100 euros there, they give away 10,000. So they create 10,000 euros for 100 you bring there. So the whole system is so sick, and you can see it here. There was a gold standard which was ended, and here you see how the trillions of dollars of the national debt of the US has risen since then. And there you see the countries which have the most debt. So the question is, I have to go further, a little bit faster because I'm behind the time. The question is, where is your focus on money in your personal life? What and who is stealing your money? What are you going to do about it? How do you compensate guilt? And what do you think, where is your money? Where is your money? And in the back you see a picture, someone has a focus, and somebody in the back is taking his money. So what is your focus, and who is stealing the money? And if you say this is some sort of inner team inside of you, who inside of you steals your money? Okay, thank you very much.